Good day to everyone. Over the years, the Central Bank of Barbados has hosted an impressive array of distinguished economists, none more so than our guest today, Dr. Fred Bergsten, founder and immediate past director of the Peterson Institute, the most influential think tank in America on matters to do with the international economy. Dr. Bergsten is one of the few persons in our profession to have had a book written in his honor on the occasion of his 65th birthday and the 25th year of the institute he founded in 2006. In the preface to that book, its editor, the late Michael Musa, himself an economist of great distinction and former chief economist of the International Monetary Fund, described Dr. Bergsten as, quote, a phenomenon among economists. In our interview today, we will speak to Dr. Bergsten's singular achievements. The Central Bank of Barbados breaks new ground with Dr. Bergsten's six-week sabbatical with us. He is our very first resident distinguished visiting fellow, and we are privileged to have someone of his distinction as our first guest in this capacity. Fred, the distinguished Barbadian scientist Dr. Ken Hayward entitled his 2011 memoir, Beyond My Wildest Dreams. Do you feel the same way about your life work?
When I first created the Peterson Institute for International Economics in 1981, I was confident it would be a success and would make a real contribution to better policies in the United States and around the world. But I must admit, I did not anticipate that it would become so influential on a global scale. I think we've been fortunate enough to be able to affect a great many really critical policies, and that does go beyond what I had hoped and even expected at the creation.
That's a good feeling. Tell us a little of your background, where you grew up, what were your early influences, and what you set out to make of your life.
Well, I was born in Brooklyn, New York, and grew up in the New York City suburbs. But my parents, who were Midwesterners, then took me to Missouri when I was in high school, and I finished high school and went to college there. I then went to graduate school back in the Northeast at the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy. And most of my career has been in New York or Washington ever since. I decided to focus on the global economy when I was in graduate school, just at the time that globalization was starting to take effect both in the United States and around the world. I made the calculated guess that global economics were going to become very important, both to the economies of individual countries, including my own, the United States, but also to international politics, world affairs, even security relations more broadly. So I decided to specialize in that area. I spent much of my first 15 to 20 professional years in the US government. I was Henry Kissinger's deputy for foreign economic policy in the White House for 3 years. I later was Undersecretary of our Treasury for International Affairs. I ran the international part of our Treasury Department. So by the age of 40, I had developed quite an extensive experience in making and carrying out foreign economic policy in the United States. On that basis, one of the U.S. foundations asked me if I would create what became the Institute for International Economics. They said they would put up the money if I would do it. After much thought and planning, I decided to do that and created the Institute in 1981. Since then, I've done a lot of commissions, both national commissions in the US and international commissions, but my life has been devoted to creating and building an institute focused on the global economy, which, as you said at the outset, has had some success in influencing events in that area.
So which of your early bosses would you say has had the greatest impact on your thinking and the greatest influence on the way you have developed subsequently?
I would say there were two early bosses who were really instrumental in the evolution of my thinking. The first was Richard Cooper, who himself was an eminent international economist. We're not very different in age, but he was my first boss in the State Department in my very first job. From him, I learned an enormous amount of international economics and particularly the critical importance of figuring out ways to get the major countries, the big economies, to cooperate with each other to promote common economic policy goals. He was superb at that. He still is, still going strong, and he taught me a lot. The second, and this may surprise you, was Henry Kissinger. Now, Henry Kissinger knew nothing about economics and still knows nothing about economics and admits that. In fact, he calls me his main teacher of international economics. Some people say that that must be like being military advisor to the Pope because he didn't learn very much. But from him, I learned an enormous amount about politics, bureaucratic maneuvering, dealing with the media, and essentially running a policy operation, the National Security Council in his case, which I was able to use very extensively later in life. So two very different bosses, two very different sets of lessons, both were very instrumental to me.
You have always been brilliant at getting your messages across. What's the key factor in effective communication?
Well, I think there are two or three things. Many economists have great difficulty communicating their thoughts, in part because they cannot resist being highly technical. And I always insist on avoiding technicalities, speaking plain English, and explaining key economic concepts in very simple terms. The second is to try to relate your message to what your viewer is interested in. I'll tell you two stories about how I did that. I used to do a lot of television interviews in the United States, particularly on NBC News, and they had a longtime economic correspondent named Irving R. Levine. He would ask me a question about some hot current topic, and I'd give him an answer, and he'd say, "Fred, that was a very good answer, but it took 13 seconds. I only have 9. Let's redo it." In other words, you have to be succinct. Then when I was at the Treasury, trying to get legislation through the Congress every year, one of my committee chairmen, who wrote the checks and therefore was critical, said, "Fred, if it takes you more than 30 seconds to explain your idea to a congressman, you'll lose him." So again, I had to be very succinct. And I think brevity, along with clarity, are probably the most essential elements in communicating.
But it really must be very difficult to combine those two things, especially when you're talking about international economics and issues relating to exchange rates and things of that nature.
Well, it is to lots of people, but I've always felt that if you took the time to really understand the issue yourself, you probably could then present it without a lot of verbiage. The critical thing is to fully grasp yourself, the concepts, the data, the analysis that you're trying to convey. But if you do that and really think it through and try to relate it to what your audience may know or not know, then I think you can find ways to put it sufficiently briefly that you'll hold your audience and maybe implant a phrase, a thought that they will take away with it, remember, and perhaps then you can get your message across. When I'm doing television interviews or media, I always say, I don't really care what he asks me. I know what I'm going to say, and I know what my answer is going to be, whatever he asks, because I know the message I want to get across. Right, right. But you have to take the time to prepare that in advance and figure out what message you want to convey, and then hit it, and hit it, and hit it again.
Right.
Repetition is also important, particularly in dealing with a broad audience, which is not interested in great details, but where you want to have one or two basic concepts or ideas or policy thoughts. You want to get one or two takeaways that your audience will be seized with.
Right. The influence of the Peterson Institute comes from the fact that it's not only you who have been able to do this very effectively, but so have all the other members of the staff, many of whom are traditional economists who in other areas and in their former lives, spoke economies just like everybody else. I mean, how did you affect that transformation, and what were the critical tools that
I did a lot of coaching of my people. But at the Institute, we have always stressed the relevance of our work to the real world. Many top-flight academic economists, in truth, are writing for other academic economists and trying to influence the intellectual debate, which is fine, but putting their message in a way that is really too technical, too abstruse for a broad audience. So I always insisted to my people, and I would coach them and kind of review how they were going to present things, that they hone their message to a broader audience, to a broader constituency that they were trying to explain things to and trying to persuade to buy their school of thought. In the early years of our Institute, I would shock my colleagues who were working for me. They would finish a really good book, and I would congratulate them, and then I would say, and now your job is half done. And they were shocked. They said, what do you mean, half done? I said, well, now you have to go out and sell it, and here's how we do that. And then we figure out the main messages, the main themes, the main lines that needed to be emphasized and underlined and conveyed to a broad audience. And that, I think, has been one of the secrets of our success. You're right, it's certainly not just me. I always tried to bring all of our senior people into that mode of addressing a broader audience, writing op-eds, speaking to the media, doing television work, testifying to the Congress, the things that require you to really focus your message on a broader audience, not just speaking to other economists.
Another thing that has really impressed me about the Institute is that you're always so fast on the draw. Whenever there is a new issue, a new topic, the first authoritative analysis inevitably comes from the Peterson Institute. We have only recently, within the last year or so, come to realize how important fracking, for example, is in the production of oil in the United States. And already the Institute has a book out on oil production and the new techniques. What's the secret?
Well, one of our cardinal operating principles has been the maintenance of what I call our rolling agenda. We are constantly trying to foresee what will be the main policy issues 2 or 3 years out, medium run horizon, not the very long run, but not immediate things either. We're not trying to second guess day-to-day policy management. We're trying to foresee the policy agenda over the medium run. We do that by talking to government officials, private sector leaders, thoughtful media, other intellectuals, academics, think tank people, but always with a focus on what issues look like rising toward the top of the global agenda over the next couple of years. If we do that right, then we can deploy our own resources to address those issues. So by the time they do come front and center, we have developed a thoughtful and hopefully helpful analysis so people can better understand the issues, and also hopefully some thoughtful policy recommendations on what to do about them. I always say we start and finish with the real world. We start by trying to define what will be the issues that policymakers and the policy world will have to address. Then we do serious, hopefully world-class analysis of them. And then we come back to the real world and say, okay, what then can be done to deal with those problems more effectively? And if we do that right, we get the result that you suggested, so that when an issue comes onto the front burner, comes into the headlines, we hopefully have already prepared something that will explain it, analyze it, and suggest how to go about dealing with it.
But isn't the issue doing it right? How do you keep your batting average above the average?
It's basically by the selection of the people to work with me at the Institute. I insist that every one of my senior staff, and there are only 20 to 25 of us who constitute the senior in-house full-time staff of the Institute, I insist that they all have two types of characteristics. One is an established track record of intellectual analysis, research, publication, credibility in that sense. But the second is experience in the real world, having worked in government, in international institutions like the IMF or the WTO, so that they combine an ability to analyze at a world-class level, but also then to apply that analysis to policy questions and practical policy solutions to those problems. I think it's that blending of intellectual excellence and real-world savvy that have enabled our institute publications and our senior people to make a real impact. And that has been one of my central requirements as I have recruited people, brought people onto my team, retained them, maintained them, and helped elevate many of them to well-known status as leading experts on their topic.
And it has worked because you've had hit after hit after hit. But you've had some misses, no?
We always miss. I suspect you personally disagree with some of our proposals. But I always say that even if you disagree with our proposals, you should still be able to use our analysis. As I mentioned before, we try to identify an issue, then we hope to do cutting-edge analysis of it, and then we make proposals, which we think derive from the analysis. But others may disagree, may have different value judgments, may have different models, but hopefully they would still respect and use our underlying economic analysis as helping them to get a better understanding of the problem and add to the core of knowledge that that the world could use to address those problems.
Let's talk about China. You were among the first to recognize the importance of China in the global economy and so on. Has the center of gravity of the world shifted decisively east, do you think?
I think the center of gravity of the world clearly is shifting east. I don't think it has shifted decisively yet. I think we're in kind of a midway point. If you look at the world economy as a whole, as you know, global output, global GDP, if you will, is now split almost evenly between the traditional high-income countries and the emerging markets and developing countries. If you do exchange rates at purchasing power parity, it's almost 50-50. Now, the emerging markets are growing three times as fast. So their share is growing by a percentage point or two every year. 10 years from now, there'll be two-thirds of the world economy. And then it might be fair to say that the world is being dominated by the emerging markets, particularly in Asia, and within that, particularly by China. So we're in a historic transition period, which historically has been very difficult to manage. It's been one of the great challenges throughout mankind to integrate effectively rising powers into the global leadership system. And many times that has failed disastrously and even led to wars. So the challenge we're facing now of finding ways that China can join responsibly in global economic leadership, cooperate with the US, with Europe, with the other traditional leaders, that is just a huge issue. It requires mindset changes on both sides of the equation. The Chinese, as they become the world's leading economy, which they will be in a few years, have to realize that responsibility goes with that. The United States, losing its position as the preeminent power, has to realize that it must now collaborate, work with others, no longer try to dominate the scene because it does not have the capability to do that. That's a very difficult change in mindset on both sides of the equation. So early on, I proposed, very controversially, the creation of kind of an informal G2 between the United States and China, through which very informally, you wouldn't announce it, you wouldn't have any formal institution, but through which they would informally but very intensively start collaborating on this transition of global economic leadership, which for a long time, I think, will require almost co-leadership between the U.S. and China, and to some extent Europe as it recovers from its crisis. But that's very hard to pull off. I think to some extent it is actually happening through intensive consultative practices between the U.S. and China, but as yet, there is no meeting of the minds on substance on major issues, and that's one reason that global economic cooperation has actually stalled out in a number of areas in the last few years with deleterious effects on the world economy.
What about the role of the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, and the other international institutions?
I think the International Monetary Fund is still absolutely essential as the fulcrum for cooperation among all the countries in the world, and particularly the major countries, in managing the world economy. Having said that, the IMF, I think, has been quite disappointing in recent years. It has been unable to win the kind of support and leadership from its key member countries that it needs. My own country, the United States, has just once again failed in the Congress to approve changes in the governance structure, which are absolutely important to maintain the legitimacy of the fund by increasing the role for these newly emerging economies. China, for its part, has, in my view, violated some of the most fundamental rules of the IMF by manipulating its currency for competitive advantage, running huge trade surpluses, piling up $4 trillion of foreign exchange reserves. So these are instances where the key countries, who in my view ought to be working intimately together to provide joint leadership of the IMF, have been failing to do so. And they're going to have to, in my view, come to some new realizations of how, particularly in this difficult transition period, the international institutions need to be used effectively. The other one that's critically important is the World Trade Organization. It has failed over the last decade as well to negotiate major trade liberalization. However, and most of that trade liberalization is now occurring, and it is occurring, but it's occurring through major regional agreements. That's okay, because that's reducing barriers. It's putting pressure on the outsiders to follow along what I call competitive liberalization. I think that's okay, but it needs to then ultimately be brought back together in a multilateral framework at the WTO. And in the meanwhile, the WTO has its very effective dispute settlement mechanism, which is really unique in international activities in any area, through which countries, including the big ones, the US, China, take each other into the WTO to defend the rules, implement the rules, and pretty much everybody accepts the rulings when they come through. So the WTO, in a way, is the most successful international economic institution now. On the other hand, by failing to achieve successful negotiations, it's had some failures too, and that one also is a big challenge.
Thanks very much, Fred. We'll take a break here and we'll be back in a minute.
This is the time to talk about the world economy and the impact on our region. The Central Bank of Barbados is hosting the first edition of the Caribbean Economic Forum with special guest C. Fred Bergsten, Distinguished Visiting Fellow of the Peterson Institute for International Economics. Join us on Wednesday, 19th February at 8 p.m. when I'll pose questions to this highly respected world economist. Pose your own questions via email and social media. This is too important to our future to miss.
Welcome back, everybody. Fred, let's talk a little bit about financing. The success of the Institute has a great deal to do with the fact that you have been able to attract the kind of financing which enables you to bring on board the talent that you have. And you have a formidable reputation as a fundraiser. What's your secret?
My fundraising technique is very simple. I spend 98% of any fundraising discussion talking about the substance of the issues that we deal with at the Institute. Because if I can appeal to my potential funders' substantive interest in the topics, then I think I'm most of the way home. Now, the last 2% of the time, I try to not let him out of the room until he signs a check, But that's it. It's based on substance and an effort to work together with others, be it foundations or companies, who believe also in a globalized economy, open trade, international economic cooperation. It is critical to have both an adequate level of funding and the right kind of funding. It needs to be diversified, so you cannot be accused of being beholden to any one supporter. It needs to be from a variety of sources. We get money from philanthropic foundations like the Ford Foundation, from private companies, from many diverse individuals who like our work. We take almost no government money from the US or any other government, and that avoids any suspicion that we're carrying water for a particular policy view. And that formula's worked out. I've been fortunate in being able to attract that type of funding as well as amounts that are necessary. And it's been critical to enable us to maintain the independence of the Institute and therefore its credibility in all quarters of U.S. society and I think internationally.
Our profession, as you know, is one which is remarkably fractious, you know, and it's very hard for people to be in bed with people with whom they have such, you know, diverse or opposing views. Is there a secret to that kind of making that kind of diversity happen within a cohesive environment?
Well, you're absolutely right. It's a fundamental issue. In fact, way back when I was creating the Institute, thinking of the model to follow, one of the most senior economists in the United States said, "Fred, you're trying to do something that is impossible. You're trying to bring world-class economists under one roof and keep them pursuing independent agendas and not going to war with each other. It won't work." Well, it has more or less worked, and he admitted 10 years later that he had been wrong. I think the reason is that all of our staff, led by me, has a concerted purpose, which is to make the world better. Sounds simplistic, but as I said before, all of our people have a combination of research excellence and practical policy experience, from which combination their goal in life is really to improve the world economy, economic policy in the US and around the world. So we have a common purpose. We may, on given issues, disagree on the best way to pursue that purpose, but we have a common interest and enough respect for each other and interest in maintaining the reputation of the Institute as a whole to cooperate in conveying the message. So even when we have sharp disagreements, we're very civil toward each other, we're very cooperative in presenting even very different views. It's taken a lot of self-restraint on the part of some of our people. There have been some cases where one of our senior scholars would feel so strongly against the view of another senior scholar that he threatened to denounce him publicly, but I kind of smoothed that over and it never happened. And it's a combination, I think, of mutual respect for the other members of the team and for the common purpose that I think in the end of the day has prevailed against, as you suggest, high odds, because that doesn't happen very often.
Yeah. Isn't it also a sense that nothing is certain? That, I mean, we may hold a particular view fairly strongly and feel that the logic of the argument goes in a certain direction, but we are never sure.
And we should all, therefore, be humble.
Yes.
And I think one trait of our economists at the Institute, even though some of them have strong egos and high reputations, they've all understood what you just said, that it, certainly in recent years, many tenets of economics that had been viewed as immutable have been kind of shaken, if not shattered. And we all have to be humble. So we put forth our best efforts and we make our best analyses, but we know, as you say, we might not be right. And therefore, we better not only tolerate alternative views, we better actually promote the development of alternative views, because over time, that's going to make for a much richer agenda and more likely successful policy.
Yeah. Let me take you back to the financing. Do you do most of the heavy lifting yourself?
Particularly in the early days of the Institute, but even more recently, I have done most of the heavy lifting, particularly with the large funders. Mm. Our funding base is actually different from that of a lot of other think tanks. We have a relatively small number of relatively large supporters. In other words, it's more kind of wholesale financing. A lot of think tanks have thousands of small supporters. We have a few hundred relatively large supporters, which means it has not been all that difficult. It hasn't taken all that much time. And as I said before, I've always been able to relate it to our substantive message. So many of our funders participate very actively in our seminars, our forums, our rollouts of our publications, our own intellectual program, and therefore continuing to attract their financial support has not been all that difficult. So it's not taken nearly as much time as you might think or fear. And since our track record has been pretty good, we've been able to retain our support. We've had very few dropouts, and we've been able to add to that over time as necessary.
Right. And has it gotten more difficult in the current recession? Many institutions are struggling because of the hard times.
The answer is the opposite.
Really? Okay.
I half joke that the global crisis has been a great thing for my institute. And the reason, of course, is that faced with all these difficulties, people need our kind of analysis even more than in the past. So unlike some institutions, we have not had funding difficulties or support difficulties in other senses during the crisis. It has, in fact, almost compelled people to pay more attention to what we say and rely more heavily on us. Many private companies have come to us during the crisis and candidly ask, how do we deal with this? We don't understand what's happening. We don't know how serious it could get. We don't know what it's, all its implications are for us. Can you help us think that through? Mm-hmm. For us, that's wonderful because then we learn more about how the economy is functioning and what the different actors are facing. But of course, it also means that their support for us is increasing, not diminishing. So I say it half jokingly because I'm not seeking global crises, but they do have the unintended effect of probably increasing interest in our work and support for it.
And these questions come from the private sector as well as from governments and international
institutions? We get this from governments and private sector. We get it from governments. When Gordon Brown and the UK were chairing the G20 summits in 2009, the critical year for responding to the crisis, started, of course, really escalated in late 2008. They came to us, Gordon Brown personally came to me, his people came to us. We had many, many brainstorming sessions where we gave them, developed for them, gave them some of the key ideas that were agreed by the G20 at the London summit in April of 2009, including the big increase in resources for the IMF to help it deal with many aspects of the crisis. The US government came to us very extensively during that period, including with some of its new trade initiatives with Asia. When the Obama administration realized they were kind of falling behind the curve on trade and maybe ceding leadership to China faster than they would have liked. And they came to us, asked for ideas. We had ideas for them. And they pursued the Trans-Pacific Partnership. So governments have come to us very extensively during this period, as well as private companies, like I mentioned.
And I find that the Institute's output is always very positive, is always very optimistic is probably not the right word, but it leads you in a way that you can see a way forward. Would you say that that's a characteristic of your approach to the international economy?
Yes, on the whole, there have been times where we have sounded alarms and warned about some developments and
for example,
suggested that, well, particularly in the early stages of the euro crisis, as I said, I was an optimist throughout, but I was quick to say that unless they dealt with three or four of the critical aspects of it, that they had lagged badly in developing the institutional machinery to handle, that they could suffer a serious collapse. And so we urged, pushed, suggested ways in which they could try to get back ahead of the curve. It took them some time to do it, given the complications of their political process, but they eventually did it. So there are occasions, certainly, on which we warn and suggest big risks. But on balance, you're right, we've tended to be optimistic, partly because we believe that with serious analysis of the type we and many others do, and an ability to communicate those to the policymakers of the day, there are remedies. There are always remedies. It's a matter of A, understanding the problem, B, having the political courage, and those are not easy in many cases. But there are always constructive answers to the problems that countries face or the world face. And since it's our business to try to provide those answers and promote their adoption, I guess we're maybe reflecting a bit of self-confidence that if only people listen and get it right, then maybe we come out of the woods.
Thank you. And you have said that there are as many as 2,000 think tanks in the United States. How have you, has the Peterson risen to the top, so to speak? And when in your 30-year odd year journey did you first begin to sense that you were the go-to institution in your area of expertise?
Well, I have to confess that we had one big advantage right from the start. Namely, there was no other U.S. institute that devoted itself solely to the world economy. Now, many other institutions, good ones like Brookings, Carnegie, did some work on the world economy. But none of them devoted themselves entirely or even primarily to that set of issues. And we were actually created on the premise that those issues were so important that they needed a laser-like focus and the development of a critical mass of talent to address that set of issues on an ongoing, consistent, hopefully thoughtful and creative way. So in a sense, we were paving new ways and did not have direct competition. We were also lucky because world events, right at the startup of the Institute, world events created huge demand for what we were doing. It was the time of the Reagan administration, which had a policy that ruined the U.S. budget and forced very high interest rates. That sent the dollar to very overvalued levels, converted the U.S. from the world's largest creditor country to the world's largest debtor country in just a few years. Huge trade deficits, protectionist pressures, that led to enormous interest in what we were doing. And of course, the third world debt crisis within the first year of our existence. So immediately, there were critical issues in our domain that fortunately we were equipped to address. And so right from the start, we attracted a lot of attention, got a lot of support for our work. And that enabled us, among other things, to fundraise and develop a reputation. But I'd say it was probably 10 to 15 years until we developed both the critical mass of talent and the reputation and credibility, which inevitably takes time to build, where we really were then at the top of the heap. There have been some think tank rankings in the last few years that have been developed. In the very first one, in 2008, we were tied with Brookings for top think tank in the world. And Brookings is 10 times bigger than we are. So I was very proud of that. There's a British group magazine called Prospects. Every year they vote top think tank in the world. In 2011, they voted us top think tank in the world. In recent years, again, we've had a favorable environment because the global economic crisis meant that people like Prime Minister of the UK and the President of the United States and his top officials would come to us for help because the issues we were working on rose to the top of their agenda. And so I'd have to say that was some good fortune, good luck, but of course you have to be able to take advantage of that. And I think by building up our staff and our credibility over the first couple of decades of our life, we were able to do that.
That's where I want to end, Alfred. The talent that you have been able to attract to the Institute, what were the key factors in being able to pull together that extraordinary group of people?
I think it's the clarity of our mission in attempting to make for a better world, better economic policies, both in the United States and abroad, and the fact that many, not all, but many world-class economists really share that objective and felt that by coming to our institute, where they could speak their mind, could be independent, could carry out a thoughtful and truly independent research agenda, but at the same time marshal the institutional reputation and credibility of the institute, they would get the best of all worlds in achieving their own objectives. And of course, it's a rolling thing. Once you get enough people to do that, then other people want to come and join the party. And so we've had a very high retention ratio. We've attracted top people, but very few have left. Because once they take advantage of our setting, they see what a benefit it is for them personally, and they want to stay on. So it's a combination of the joint mission and the realization of the objectives of the kind of people that that we attract. We also have a very progressive and very efficient research environment. The support we provide, the research assistance, all those things I've always emphasized.
And the classy headquarters.
In classy headquarters, we built our own building, which won all sorts of architectural awards, lots of good art in it. So I've always tried to provide a kind of optimal research environment for our people. I always say to folks who are considering an academic alternative, come to us. You don't have any academic committees. You don't have to have any long meetings. You can do research. And that's what the really thoughtful people want to do. And we provide an environment where they can do it and have a real payoff in what they achieve.
Thanks very much, Fred. A wonderful experience it must have been for you, and it's great to have you with us and to be able to share that experience with you. Thanks so much.
Well, it's a great pleasure and honor to be here with you and have the opportunity to do so.
Ladies and gentlemen, thanks very much for joining us. Dr. Fred Bergsten, our distinguished visiting fellow at the Central Bank of Barbados, with us on a short sabbatical for 6 weeks. He has shared with you his extraordinary achievements and the achievements of his institute, the Peterson Institute in Washington, D.C.